Good evening and welcome to the May 11th Salisbury City Council Legislative Session. We have a full audience, I think I know why. The t-shirts give you away. Thank you all for joining us and at home on PAC 14. We're going to begin the evening with our invocation from Pastor Bunting from the Emmanuel Wesleyan Church here in Salisbury. If you wouldn't mind joining us. Thank you.
You'll be standing as we go to prayer.
Our precious Heavenly Father, we pause the beginning of this meeting tonight, God, and for the city council, Lord, we lift them up to you, Lord, and the mayor. I pray, Father, for this meeting and the days to come, Lord, that you would lead and guide and direct them, the future of our city, Lord. We pray for all the department heads. We pray especially, Father, for the police department, Lord, and we pray for our firefighters, and we pray for the citizens of Salisbury. That, Lord, you would put a hedge around this city, Lord, and you protect them, and may we speak prosperity and blessings upon this city. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
If you'll join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Okay. Our first order of business tonight is our community organization presentation that we have started doing with the City Council, and I encourage anyone who wants to participate in that to come to let us know and let the City Clerk know or contact myself so that we can get you on the agenda. So you can come and share some information about your mission and what you're doing and how we can help you with that. Tonight we have guests from Emmanuel Wesleyan Church as well. They're kind of taking over the first part of the agenda here tonight, which is great. And they're celebrating their one-year anniversary of Adopt-A-Block program, and Mark Thompson is going to share that information with us. Mark?
Well, good evening to Vice President, I'll call you President, Lower Mitchell, to President Day in his absence and the Mayor in his absence, and to the members of the City Council. Thank you for this opportunity to come to speak to you this evening. Concerning our Adopt-A-Block ministry at the Emmanuel Wesleyan Church. Before I begin, I want to say the words of a song that really typifies what Adopt-A-Block is. And it was written by these words by Matthew West. He said these words in this song. He said, "I woke up this morning, saw a world full of trouble now. Thought, how will we ever get so far down? How is it ever going to turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold in slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. So I said, God, why don't you do something? And he said, I did. I created you." And this is what Adopt-A-Block is all about. God has created us at this time in our lives here at Emmanuel Wesleyan. We are his hands who knock on over 100 doors delivering food, which includes over 800 to 1,000 pounds of food a month, plus 1,400 pounds of fresh vegetables that we serve to the people in the Church Street areas. We are God's hands where we deliver clothes and household items. We have delivered over 10 beds to people who are still sleeping on the floor here in Salisbury, Maryland. During Christmas time, we delivered over 350 presents to children in this area. We're God's legs. We're walking around the Church Street neighborhoods of Barkley, Baker, Martin, and Church Street, Naylor Streets. Every other Saturday, not just a one-time event, but this is every other Saturday since last March, we've been going out into this neighborhood, giving words of encouragement, motivating people, providing school supplies. We bring in information from the health departments and the Department of Social Services. We have a heart for people. In fact, the mission of Adopt-A-Block is quite simply, find a need and fill it, find a hurt and heal it. So what is so remarkable about all of this is really that now we're bringing the community together in the last year. We bring teachers from East Salisbury, Wicomico Early Learning Center, Beaver Run Elementary Schools, and East Salisbury come together, and the teachers, the principal, administration actually go on the streets to visit the children in their schools, in their homes where they really are. We've also added the Korean Presbyterian Church, which has joined with us. They go out with us every other Saturday into the neighborhoods, and we're expanding our territories to cover more of Salisbury. In fact, we've even had people down in Cape Charles call us to find out how to start an Adopt the Block program. So we're doing more than just what you see every other Saturday, but we're creating an epidemic that's going to start a trend in our community where community members provide for community members. Our goal is to create a dream center there on Naylor and Church Street where we can provide 24-hour, 24/7 addiction counseling and services, where we can have transitional housing. Thanks to our pastor, Pastor Bunting, for the last 30 years, his vision has always been to serve the people of this community, and I think we're doing it right now. We want to make Salisbury an even better place to live because we're part of it. We are God's hands. We're God's workmanship. So again, I just want to show you what we do, and it's a brief presentation of how we go out every other Saturday. Once again, this isn't just a one-time thing, but we go out every other Saturday. We go out when it's snow out on the streets, and that's our friend and our brother from the Korean Presbyterian Church. There we are packing food every other Saturday at the Miracle Building at Emmanuel Wesleyan. There's Pastor Bunting, and this is just typifies what we do when we go out on the streets where we have prayer with the neighbors. A lot of people just stop us to ask us for prayer. There we are again with groups of us. This is during the winter time. I just wanted to show that we go out no matter what the weather conditions are like. There we are again out in the parking lot across from the Christian shelter. And what was so ironic here, we have a lot of Haitian families that live in this area. And during this time, they come out, and they're not accustomed to the snow, but they come out in their flip-flops out in the snow, and we tell them, go back home, we'll deliver the food to you. And there we are packing the food. There we are during the summer, just last week, in fact, we pick up trash, our goal is to enable the community to start taking pride in their community. They see us picking up the trash, we want them to pick up their own trash. And that's how we deliver our food. We have two very fine, capable drivers. We have one here, Brother Sims, takes his truck out on one area, and we go out and we deliver the food, knock on every house we knock on. And that's what it looks like with our group. And then we ask them if they need any assistance, and that's when we find out what kind of needs the people may need. And this is just typifies the Adopt the Block program, showing love to our community. This is what it's all about. We have so many hugs from strangers on the streets, but we find out now we're all just one family. So again, we're proud of our Adopt the Block ministry at Emmanuel Wesleyan. Mm-hmm. But again, this could not have been done without the vision of our pastor, Pastor Tom Bunting. And tonight we just want to recognize him, some of our members of our church, just to say thank you for his leadership and providing for us. And again, this isn't government funding. All of this is provided through the members of the Emmanuel Wesleyan Church. So again, thank you all. We're also inviting you to our block party. It should be May 23rd. We'll send out some information about that. We have a big celebration down there on the parking lot where across from the Christian shelter. I guess there is one thing we do ask. We still need to find a playground, a safe place for our children to play in the Church Street neighborhood. We have vacant lots down there. I know we talked about that open space money before. I am going to be talking with Dr. Whitehead. He has some funds through a program that he's running. But we need to create a safe place, a playground, some area for the children. We found with the 300 toys that we delivered, that was 300 children we delivered to. So there's a lot of children in the neighborhood that can't make it to Ben's Red Swings. Right. So again, thank you for tonight.
If you could, Mr. Thompson, how can people get involved? Who do they call? Is there a website, a phone number? How can they help in terms of donations? Do you accept donations?
Yeah, we do accept donations, clothing. They can contact me at the church. You go ewchurch.com, and when you pull up ewchurch.com, I'm sure that is right. I'm looking at that, Pastor Mark, ewchurch.com, and you look under staff, and you'll see my picture, and you can just email me. You can email any of the pastors at the church, and we'll contact you, or call the number that's on our website, ewchurch.com, and we'll get right back to you. That's one thing that we do. We get right back to you.
Okay.
Mark, when's the next Saturday that you do the
May 23rd. May 23rd.
But that's when you're having your block
party. That's when a block party. Yeah, right. But we go out every other Saturday. So we went out this past Saturday, and it's religiously every other Saturday. Okay. We start at 9:30. We pack the food. We get our food from the food bank. And then we head out. We're also emergency shelter for Wicomico County. So during the week, I receive a lot of calls on people requesting assistance for food during the weekday. But we leave by 9:30, 10 o'clock, and we go out into the neighborhood and deliver the food, clothes, whatever the need is for that day.
Okay. I have a proclamation for Pastor Bunting, if you would join me at the podium. And for Mr. Thompson, if you would stand. And anyone else who wants to join us? Yes, absolutely. Yes. The city would also like to recognize the efforts that you've put into this Adopt a Block program. So I have a proclamation from the mayor in his absence. Whereas Pastor Bunting was ordained through the Wesleyan Church in 1985, accepted a pastoral position at Emmanuel Wesleyan Church in Salisbury, Maryland in 1986, and launched a 28-year growth spurt that saw Salisbury attendance grow from just under 100 people to an average of 2,000 people, and both the church property and the facilities expand to meet the growing congregation's needs. And whereas Pastor Bunting saw a need in the Salisbury community and in January of 2014 began preparations for launching a local program modeled after a Los Angeles area Adopt a Block program established by Pastor Matthew Barnett, which provided ministry opportunities to numerous people in downtown Los Angeles. And whereas the Emmanuel Wesleyan Church Adopt a Block program is 1 year strong in its ministry, providing food, clothing, small home repairs, and other family essential items to residents in the Church Street neighborhood, serving over 97 homes and over 450 people. And whereas Pastor Bunting's Adopt a Block program, which meets residents' physical needs and ministers to their spiritual needs, has been a positive influence in the Church Street neighborhood. Now, therefore, I, James Ireton, mayor of the city of Salisbury, do hereby proclaim that May 23rd, 2015, as Adopt a Block Day in Salisbury. In our city, in celebration of the program's one-year anniversary and in recognition of Pastor Tom Bunting's vision, his compassion in establishing the program for the Church Street neighborhood, and his longtime devotion to his congregation and his overall ministry to Salisbury and its neighboring communities. Thank you very much. Did you want a picture of the proclamation? Him with the proclamation. Come back in here.
And we also just like to thank some of the members from Adopt the Block, if they can stand one more time. Just thank you for coming, spending time down here with us.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I'll see you tomorrow morning. Okay. I'm just playing.
Okay. Next up on the agenda, we have a proclamation for Bike to Work Week. Is there anyone here for Bike to Work? I don't see anybody, but we'll do the proclamation.
Okay, thank you. Whereas bicycle commuting is an effective means to improve air quality, reduce traffic congestion, and conserve energy, and whereas bicycle commuting benefits both employees and employers through better employee health and fitness, reduced commuting and parking costs, and whereas the city recently received money from the Maryland Department of Transportation funding for new bike lanes, signage, grate replacement, and a bike sharing feasibility study, and whereas the city has created the Bicycle Pedestrian Safety Advisory Committee to promote bicycling and organizes Bike to Work Day along with Bike SBY, and whereas the week of May 11th is National Bike to Work Week, which promotes bicycling as a viable means of transportation to and from work, now therefore I, on behalf of Mayor James Ireton Jr., Mayor of the City of Salisbury, do hereby proclaim Friday, May 15th, 2015 as Bike to Work Day in our city, and ask all citizens to join me in recognizing this day. witnessed this day, May 11th, 2015. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So we should expect a lot of bicycles outside on Friday. Great. Thank you very much. Okay. Next up, I will entertain a motion for the adoption of the legislative agenda as presented.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Okay, seeing none, call the question. All in favor of the adoption of the legislative agenda as presented, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you very much. Next, I will entertain a motion for the adoption of the consent agenda.
So moved. Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? Oh, I'm sorry. I guess we need to hear
we'll
it
do
first,
that
don't we? I always try to rush you, Kim.
Good evening.
Good evening.
On the consent agenda tonight, we have the April 6th and the April 13th closed session minutes, the April 20th work session minutes, and resolution number 2497, allowing the chief of police or the chief's representative to sign a memorandum of agreement and to accept funds in the amount of $10,000 in cooperation with the Wicomico County Health Department Drug Prevention Office to provide for overtime reimbursement to police officers participating in a program intended to reduce underage drinking in the city of Salisbury. And that would be it.
Okay. Any questions or discussion? All those in favor of the consent agenda?
Aye.
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 Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, I will entertain a motion for the acceptance of the award of bids.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. Okay. Ms. Miller.
Thank you. Good evening, you. Everybody.
Good evening.
We have three items this evening: one award of bid, one change order, and one declaration of surplus.
Love variety.
What?
Variety.
I try to keep it going. All right, the first item this evening is award of bid for contract 115-13. That's the Waverly Drive Water Quality Inlet Project. In August 2013, the City of Salisbury Internal Services Department Procurement Division received a request from the Department of Public Works to solicit bids for contract 115-13, Waverly Drive Water Quality Inlet. This project was to furnish all labor, materials, and equipment necessary for the installation of approximately 10 inlet-type precast bioretention units along Waverly Drive, South Boulevard, and Hanover Street. On October 28, 2013, the city awarded the bid to Bramble Construction in the amount of $494,085.60. While working with MDE to obtain the project funding, the bid proposal from Bramble Construction expired, and Bramble determined that they would not proceed to enter into a contract with the City of Salisbury. As such, the Department of Public Works consulted with MDE to secure their approval to negotiate with the second low bidder, Hopkins Construction, to perform the project with reduced scope of work in keeping with the MDE loan award amount of $494,085.60. Hopkins and the city have developed a revised scope of work, and MDE gave approval on April 2nd, 2015 for the city to execute the contract with Hopkins Construction. There are sufficient funds in the account that I've noted in the packet. The Procurement Department requests Council's approval to award contract 115-13 Waverly Drive Water Quality Inlet Project to Hopkins Construction in the amount of $494,085.60.
I just have one question on that. What was the intended number or the intended scope of the project originally and as opposed to where we are now?
Mike, do you have specific information on how that revised scope of work looks different?
Paul Maurer is our engineer on that. He's on his way up. You guys are way ahead of schedule, which is great. But now, one of the problems we had with this is as the project went ahead, Bramble, I think, had the impression they were going to be doing this out of their normal project schedule where they do a lot of paving work. With the time with the MDE approvals, as you know, can get long with that. The time exceeded with that. We consulted with legal to see if we could force them to still do the project, and the time window had passed with that. So The unfortunate thing is the grant money was set, so we couldn't go to the second low bidder at a higher number. So we had to revise the scope of work to bring it down within that and work with the second low bidder to do that. And here's Paul with good timing.
Perfect timing.
Do you remember, Paul, the number of units we had to reduce to get Hopkins in from what to what?
The original bid had 10.
Could you come to the,
oh, yeah.
Join us at the microphone?
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening. Good evening. Thank you.
So the original bid had 10 buyer retention units with one ad alternate that was accepted for a total of 11 units. And the revised bid with Hopkins will have 8 units. Okay. So it'll be 3 less.
Okay. Are these the tree in the drain things?
Yes. Yeah, they're they essentially go right upstream of an existing inlet, and the water that would normally go in the inlet will go in these buyer retention units and will be filtered by a tree, and that'll uptake the nutrients. And
we did some previously, right? We got some done, or is this the original ones we were talking about? That
this is the original ones from back in, I think, 2012. Yes.
Okay.
Now, we also have the ones that'll be part of the Main Street Master Plan.
Right, right. So but on Waverly, this is it. These
that's
will
correct.
Be the first ones. Okay.
Yes.
I have a quick question.
Pardon me.
Go ahead.
Will this be it for Waverly, or the remainder three on a different plan?
So I believe that there are 4 or 5 that will actually be on Waverly Drive, 2 or 3 right behind the hospital. Mm-hmm. I think it's 2 right behind Red Door. Another one will be just on the other side of Rita's at the M&T Bank.
Right.
And another one will be located at Hanover and Monticello Avenue at that intersection.
To answer your question, if we get more grant money or through our stormwater fee, it would be the potential, because we have the design already, to be able to go back in and bid and get some more installed.
That does answer my question.
So it would be less lag time in the future. And and did they determine that we would get credit for these against the TMDL requirements?
Oh, the systems that will go in meet the state requirements as a best management practice. Now, in the time that may go by to the next one, more of these systems may be approved, so there may be more alternates that may be available. And again, the hope is that as more of these get in, the cost of these things per unit will drop, and be able to do more as we go. But yes, we'll be as more added, we'll continue to provide that information to MDE as far as getting credits for stormwater.
Ms. Shields,
the question I had to ask is nothing technical or anything. That stuff that's on Waverly Drive in that parking lot, is that part of that construction? You know, the stones and it's in the parking lot behind Goodwill. Is that part of the stuff that stopped?
No, that was the loading dock improvements for PRMC, I think is what you're referring to. And they had using that as a staging area. I think that's what you're referring to.
It's been the same stuff on that parking lot.
It's been delayed for quite a while.
I know there was some kind of delay in there, and I just wanted
where they opened it up, they realized they had to put this huge manhole in the middle of the street. And just recently they did the work, but it was held up weather-wise and all kinds of things.
This looks ungodly, that's why I'm saying.
Yeah, it was a contractor staging area.
Okay, all right. Thing.
Funny you should mention that, because if you could reach out, Mr. Stevenson, to whoever is leasing that property or whoever owns it, to cut down that tree that's on the corner of Ohio and Waverly. It's a volunteer bush there, and it makes it difficult to see around that corner.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, that's fine.
All right, the second item is the change order number 4 to contract A-07-14. The City of Salisbury Internal Services Department, Procurement Division, received a request from the Department of Public Works to process change order number 4 in the amount of $39,500 for contract A-07-14, street improvements, curb, gutter, and sidewalk construction. Additional funds have come available to provide for property owner repairs or replacement of curb, gutter, and sidewalk, and to provide miscellaneous concrete work at the wastewater treatment plant. Funds are available in the accounts noted in your packet. The Department of Internal Services Procurement Division requests Council's approval for change order number 4, as noted above, to Malone and Phillips in the amount of $39,500.
When you say property owner repairs and replacement, that's on a cost share basis generally, unless we've had to tear it up for some reason. Is that correct?
Yeah, that is correct.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions?
Okay. Okay. The last item this evening is the declaration of surplus. On January 15th, 2015, the procurement department issued a rebid solicitation for the Bricks, a city-owned property built in 1920 and located at 432 to 434 East Church Street in Salisbury. The due date for bids was March 19, 2015, and the city received no proposals. The administration sought the advice of City Council at a closed session on April 8, 2015, at which the council directed the procurement department to request a declaration of surplus at the next legislative meeting. The Procurement Division now requests Council's approval to declare said property surplus and to allow the City of Salisbury Internal Services Department, Procurement Division, to again offer the property for sale via Council-designated terms and conditions.
Any questions? Okay. I'll call the question for the adoption of the acceptance of the award of bids. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Chair votes aye. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. Next item, resolutions presented by Mr. Tom Stevenson. Thank you. I'll entertain a motion to accept the resolution number 2498 to establish a green team.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you. Resolution 2498 is a resolution of the City of Salisbury that will establish a green team that will take part in the Sustainable Maryland certification process. Whereas the City of Salisbury is committed to providing a safe and sustainable community, seeking to optimize quality of life for its residents, ensuring clean land, air, and water, and improving working and living environments that will thrive well into future endeavors. And whereas the City of Salisbury wishes to support the green team that will lead the charge to help the City of Salisbury achieve sustainable Maryland certification and at the same time leverage the skills, expertise, and life experience of the team members to develop policies and plans, implement programs, and assist with educational opportunities that will advise staff and community leaders. Therefore, be it resolved that the City of Salisbury, Maryland, that a green team is hereby established to advise the city officials and staff on sound development and management of the city's sustainability in relation to infrastructure, accessibility, and promoting the benefits of these systems, and shall have the following attributes. It goes on to discuss the responsibilities, membership, holdover, reappointment, leadership, meetings, quorum, staff support, council liaison, recommendations. This is one of the requirements for the designation, and I believe in the cover memo it says that establishing this green team will earn the city 20 of the 150 points required for the designation.
And this is one of the mandatory requirements?
Yes.
So you have to earn this 20 points, so the rest don't matter. Mr. Moult, if you could join us.
Sure.
And just share with the public a little bit about like how close we are. You shared some of that at the, I remember when I first saw this at an MML fall conference, and I've gone down the checklist and I thought, well, we got like 180 points already, but they didn't have the mandatory items in there at that point. So if you could just share a little bit about that and how people that are interested in serving on the green team would go about that.
Okay, thank you. Yes, as you mentioned, the sustainable communities, which is what we're trying to obtain that designation through the state of Maryland as a community that is interested in sustainability and protecting the environment. There's a number of action items there, and two of those action items are mandatory. One is the creation of the green team, and then the second is for the green team to develop an action plan. A number of items, categories that can go through to earn points, and we need to have a total of 150 points, including those two mandatory actions and two of six priority actions to obtain that designation. We sat down with representatives of Sustainable Maryland and went through the list and the different categories I'll touch on. Community action, community-based food system, which would be like a community garden, local farmers markets, energy, municipal energy audits, innovative demonstration projects, greenhouse gas is our municipal carbon footprint, and that's where we're working with the Shore Power Project to develop our city carbon footprint and update that. Health and wellness, workplace wellness, local economies, buying local, campaigning information to encourage people to buy locally as opposed to buying from distant areas, and then you have the energy that's used to bring those products to you when they could be obtained locally. Also natural resources, watershed stewardship, stormwater management. We get credit for our stormwater utility fee. And then also planning and land use are the different categories. Within those categories, we're looking with that we have would have the 150 points that we would need to become a Sustainable Maryland certified municipality. So that this next step will generate, get our green team together. I've had several people express some interest in being on it. If there is anybody that would like to be a member of the green team, please can contact me through the Department of Public Works, and we can get a list together and follow up with them to see if they're as far as setting up our team. We're anxious to get that started so we can get that certification going.
Okay. And that will open up some grant opportunities for us that aren't presently available, is that correct?
Absolutely.
Okay. One question I had about the structure, and that is under the council liaison. In other portions, it specifically says, for instance, the staff support that they are an ex officio member, non-voting member. The council liaison does not specify whether they are a voting member of the committee or not. I believe on most of our committees they are, but it doesn't specify that here.
Okay. And that would be, I guess, an option if council would decide their member to have a voting block. We can certainly modify that.
Sometimes that helps to get the quorum as well. Without that, you may not have one.
I know what you mean there.
Is there a preference of council?
Not really.
No, let's have a brief discussion about it, actually.
Okay.
Not right this second. Oh, we could, Dan.
Well, if we're going to adopt this, it needs to probably say whether they're voting or not.
I would prefer there would be a voting member, yes.
Okay. I think I would, too.
Well, what's the difference between the committees that have one and don't have a voting member?
Mr. Spees, you were shaking your head that indicating that the others may not, but the ones that I know of do. Park committee, you have a vote on that. The zoo commission, you have a vote. The
bicycle, you don't. And TSAC, you don't.
Okay, so some of the more recent commission. It's probably split 50-50. Mr. Stevenson, any input from you?
I think it's a good, probably a good idea, I guess, if you're concerned about getting the quorum, but it really, you know, it's like you said, it's 50-50. It doesn't matter where we are.
Because I think liaison is something to bring back information to the council. I don't think it should be involved in the voting. You know?
Well, all they're doing is making recommendations anyway, so whether it makes it out of there or not. How many members are on it altogether?
Five.
Yeah, minimum of five.
Minimum of five.
Well, whatever the majority says, because it doesn't really make one difference. Yeah.
We'll just leave it as is. If it becomes a quorum becomes an issue, then
it can always be.
Without any quasi judicial power, it doesn't really matter one way or the other.
Really, it's mostly a matter of having a quorum. If they're ex officio, they don't really.
And if that's the crux of the matter, then make it happen. That's
to make
the quorum. Quorum. Yeah, to take it to make
it would
them
be three,
voting
right?
Number just for a quorum.
Three of the five. Mr. Tillman just left the room. There's language in Mr. Tillman.
Yes.
Under the council liaison, could you suggest specific language that would indicate that the council member is a voting member?
What I would recommend, if you're going to do that, is to eliminate the reference to the liaison altogether and just put one council member up under the membership.
Council representative?
Yes.
Okay. So just strike line 64 through 66 and under the membership add... Five residents of the city, and then at the end of that sentence with the staggered terms, or where would you suggest that? I can't make the motion, so I wanted you to give specific language for someone.
Yeah, else. As far as the, I was trying to turn my phone off just a second ago when it started ringing. Did as far as staggered terms go, we're establishing this board for the first time.
Right.
So we're going to appoint everyone at the same time and then have their terms terminate at different times, correct?
Correct.
All right. Was there any decision on how long they, how that would work?
Didn't know that we were looking for one. But what we were trying to do now was to make sure that the council representative on this committee is a voting member rather than ex officio. Because that section immediately followed the staff support section where it said that they are not a voting member.
Right. Well, where it says there, it says the members of the green team may include appointed municipal staff, elected officials. And then I would just, after that sentence, I would say that the team shall include at least one council member to be designated by the council.
As a voting member?
Mm-hmm. As a voting member, yes. Right after line 38. I would just add that as an additional sentence.
Why do we need to be a voting member?
Well, that's what we were just...
Why do you need to be a voting member?
There's no need.
Mostly so they have a quorum.
I'm just providing language.
This is just another thing you have to be on. You know what I mean?
That's well, it's already...
I mean, you can be an ex officio member, but when you are a member, remember, when you vote this county, that's a mandatory that you should be there at the meeting. I don't know why we always have to be, you know... Ex officio was fine with me, because then you're not obligated, technically you're not obligated to attend the meetings.
Well, if you're a member of the committee,
up,
then...
Something comes up that you can't attend the meeting, they might not have a quorum anyway.
True, but that happens whether you're ex officio or not, whether they have, that you're expected to be there if you're a member of the committee, in my thinking.
Yeah.
I don't know, if someone wants to make
that.
The motion,
I'm not
we,
vote
can,
for that
we can do that.
Majority rules, I'm not going to vote for voting rights.
I tend to agree with Ms. Shields on this one.
Okay.
I don't see the need, and I think that, especially for this kind of team, I think you're not going to have any trouble with a quorum.
Okay.
I think the people who are going to be on this are going to be very committed to it, in my opinion.
Okay.
On problem solved.
Right, well... Then that, it still goes back to my original question of do we need to specify in that council liaison section that they are non-voting, that they're ex officio?
I don't think you need to specify that, but I do think about being invited to attend. I think that we should have it as a standing obligation of one or more council members. Unless you mean by invited, just the memorandum goes out.
Just so, yeah, we know when the meetings are, and I would imagine they'd be on a regular basis like all the others, but Mr. Tillman, is it necessary to specify whether they're voting or not?
No, because okay. The lines 33 through 38 designate who the members of the board are, and that the council liaison is someone not a member.
Okay.
It's possible for elected officials to be members, I guess, but right. Whoever is designated liaison would not be that person.
Right, and that was part of the discussion. Some of our boards and commissions we are, and some apparently we are not. So, okay, then that's fine. Question answered. Any further discussion? Okay, I'll call the question on resolution 2458. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay, next up is resolution 2499, accepting a donation for various construction materials for the Salisbury Skate Park Committee. From the Salisbury Skate Park Committee, excuse me. Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you. Resolution of the City of Salisbury, Maryland, accepting donation of various construction materials from the Salisbury Skate Park Committee to be utilized in construction of the Salisbury Skate Park in order to reduce the overall materials cost and leverage the existing available project funding. Whereas the funding available for phase one of the Salisbury Skate Park has been obtained through grants from the Maryland Department of Natural Resources and the Tony Hawk Foundation and funds donated by the local community members. And whereas the members of the Salisbury Skate Park Committee have been seeking additional donations for the project from local businesses in the form of materials that are needed for the construction of phase one of the skate park. And whereas two local businesses, 84 Lumber and Rommel's Ace Hardware, have pledged to donate various building materials to the Salisbury Skate Park Committee to be utilized in construction of phase one of the skate park. And the skate park committee wishes to have these donations formally accepted by the city so that they may be utilized. And whereas the acceptance of these construction materials will enable the city to leverage the funds available for the project, which will expand the amount of skating surface that can be created in phase one. And whereas the city's gift policy requires that such gifts can only be accepted with the approval of the City Council, and now therefore be resolved by the City of Salisbury, the City of Salisbury, Maryland, that the following donated materials be accepted from the Salisbury Skate Park Committee and utilized in the construction of the City of Salisbury Skate Park. Would you like me to read through that list of materials?
No. Okay. That's okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. I would like to thank 84 Lumber and Rommel's Ace Hardware for their very generous donations and encourage others to get on board. If there are more materials, I'm quite sure that we could use some more, and we'll be happy to accept those as well. Are there any questions or discussion?
Thank you.
All right. All those in favor of approval of resolution number 2499?
I think we need a motion and a second first. I didn't hear.
Oh, no, it wasn't.
I thought we did.
So move.
I'm sorry.
Second.
Thank you.
Thank you. My apologies.
That's okay.
First, I was rushing them to approve you, and now I'm okay. All those in favor now?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you. Entertain a motion for resolution number 2500.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Stevenson, you're on.
Thank you. Resolution 2500, a resolution of the Council of the City of Salisbury, Maryland, accepting funds awarded through a grant from Program Open Space for a boathouse at the Port of Salisbury. Whereas the City of Salisbury recognizes the important role that our local parks, playgrounds, and recreational areas play in maintaining a healthy, pleasant, attractive environment for the enjoyment of our local residents, and whereas the Council wishes to rehabilitate, improve, and expand the parks, playgrounds, and recreational areas within the City of Salisbury in order to improve the quality of life, whereas the Department of Natural Resources has awarded a program open space grant to the City of Salisbury for a recreational project in the following amount: Port of Salisbury, construction of an 80 by 50 boathouse at a cost of $90,000. Now, therefore, be it resolved that on this 11th day of May, 2015, that the Council of the City of Salisbury, Maryland, does hereby accept the funds awarded through Program Open Space for the project as funded and in the amount outlined above.
Any questions or discussion?
Yes, I do. The DNR gave this open space money because it was near the water.
You want to speak to that, Mike?
Because it was near the water.
I'm sorry, did you say it was because it was near?
I said the DNR donated this program open space grant because it's near the water, the boathouse.
Yeah, it's if you remember, there was also a companion grant that we got awarded for $40,000 for the kayak launch, the floating dock there. And then the lead on to that was potential interest. Hopefully we can generate to develop rowing teams. And DNR has a component with their open space program, which I guess is part of the overall recreation, is to encourage people to get outside and exercise. And they recognize with a lot of land that is waterfront being bought up in private, how valuable it is to have public land on the waterfront and be able to do that.
Okay. Having access to it.
Yes.
Seeing it's not enough if you can't get to it.
Exactly.
Any other questions or discussion? All right. We'll call the question on resolution 2500. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. The chair votes aye. Okay, and finally, resolution number 2501. I'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you again. Here I go. Resolution 2501, a resolution of the City of Salisbury authorizing the mayor or the city administrator to sign the donation agreement to accept the donation of the real property located at 806 North Division Street, Salisbury, Maryland, 21801 from Wells Fargo Bank. Whereas the City of Salisbury is interested in obtaining foreclosed and or abandoned properties which create a blighting influence on our neighborhoods so that said properties may be either rehabilitated for resale or demolished to make way for new construction. And whereas Wells Fargo Bank acquired the property located at 806 North Division Street, Salisbury, Maryland, through the process of foreclosure, and whereas Wells Fargo Bank has offered to donate the property to the City of Salisbury, and whereas Wells Fargo Bank has agreed to pay all closing costs associated with the transfer of the property, included but not limited to attorney's fees, agent's fees, and recording costs, and whereas Wells Fargo Bank has agreed to pay all utility bills that are due and all taxes that are due on the property up to the date of closing, and whereas Wells Fargo Bank has also agreed to provide $10,000 in seller concessions to the City of Salisbury upon closing, now therefore be it resolved that the City of Salisbury that the City Council of the City of Salisbury, Maryland does hereby authorize the mayor of the City of Salisbury to sign the donation agreement to accept the donation of real property located at 806 North Division Street, Salisbury, Maryland, 21801 from Wells Fargo Bank. Whew, got it.
Good job. I have a question for Mr. Tillman. In the acknowledgments and release, number 2.1... L. These are exclusions for the donor that they will not cover. And then in L, it talks about taxes. So if they're paying all the taxes through the closing date, I'm a little confused about why this is in here saying that we're responsible for any taxes, real estate, real property taxes or assessments or personal property taxes, if I'm reading this correctly.
And you're referring to L, the status of any general?
2L.
This is one of those I read weeks and weeks ago.
2L.
All right, so in other words, we're taking the property subject to this. In other words, they're not guaranteeing that the taxes are necessarily paid, is what that's saying. But we don't record the deeds in this county until they are paid. So they should be paid prior to recording of any deed. So,
well, and part of the agreement is no that liability. They will pay the taxes, correct?
Hmm?
Part of the agreement is that they'll pay any outstanding taxes.
But this is specifically referring not to that the taxes are paid. It says it's referring to the status of any general or special real property taxes or assessments. In other words, they're not certifying that to us. It's up to us to figure that out ourselves, is what they're saying.
Okay. So any other taxes from any
We'll have to look it up and make sure that the taxes are paid or not paid. That's going to be on us to look it up, but not on us to pay it.
Okay. And then under number 4.1, successors and assigns, I was a little confused by that, which is not really hard to do, in terms of our ability to transfer this property to someone else if they wanted to use it for transitional living or something like that, and we wanted to make that donation, or Salisbury Neighborhood Housing or anybody else.
They're not referring to us transferring the property after we take ownership of it. They're just saying that prior to taking ownership, we have no right to assign it to anyone else.
Okay.
That's what they're saying.
Okay. I just wanted to clarify. Okay. That's all I had. Any other questions? Or? Okay. Seeing none, I'll call the question on Resolution 2501. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you very much, Mr. Stevenson.
Thank you. Got that out okay.
It's okay. It's Monday.
Yeah.
Every time we meet, it's Monday. Just about. Okay. Next up are the ordinances that will be presented by City Attorney Mark Tillman. I'll first entertain a motion for the adoption of ordinance number 2328.
So moved.
For second reading.
Second.
Mr. Tillman.
Okay.
This is an ordinance of the city approving a budget amendment of FY 2015 Fire Department budget to transfer insurance funds received by the city to the Fire Department operating budget from the general fund revenue received for repairs performed on the tanker slash engine 1-1 and tower 16. And this is second reading, and basically, as a result of the insurance proceeds received, we're basically putting the money back in the fire department budget for the money that was spent now that the money's been received from the carrier. And we would increase the general fund revenue insurance proceeds account 01000-456935 by $16,276.92 and increase the department's budget by an equivalent amount.
Questions? Okay. Seeing none, I'll call the question on ordinance number 2328 for second reading. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Thank you very much. And next up, I'll entertain a motion for ordinance number 2329 for second reading for no parking zone on Pine.
So moved. Second.
Okay, this is the second reading of this ordinance. It's an ordinance of the City of Salisbury to designate a no parking zone on Pinehurst Avenue between Smith Street and Lower Crop Avenue and a restricted parking zone on Pinehurst Avenue between Camden Avenue and Smith Street. This ordinance reads as it did previously, except for under the now therefore be it ordained by the City Council of the City of Salisbury, Maryland. The language was added with regard to the days and hours when the restricted parking would occur. And other than that, it's exactly as it was read the first time. So it now reads, now therefore be it ordained by the City Council of the City of Salisbury, Maryland, to designate a no parking zone on Pinehurst Avenue between Smith Street and Lower Crop Avenue and a restricted parking zone on Pinehurst Avenue between Camden Avenue and Smith Street to disallow parking Monday through Friday between 8:30 a.m. and 7:30 p.m., except by permit.
Questions, comments, concerns? Seeing none, I'll call the question on ordinance number 2329 for second reading. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay, thank you. And next up, ordinance 2339, I'll entertain a motion for second reading.
Second.
Easement.
I think they, what's the number?
I'm sorry, 2330.
Thank you.
I was mixing them. Mix and match.
Just trying to catch.
Ordinance number 2330.
So
we have a motion and a
second.
Do we get a second? Okay, thank you. Mr. Tillman.
Okay, this is the second reading of this ordinance, whereas the City of Salisbury owns wastewater pumping stations located on Fishwater Street and Delaware Avenue and Ridge Road, and whereas the city is performing upgrades at the aforementioned pumping stations, whereas the upgrades include new electric services from Delmarva Power, which require placement of new transformers on the city-owned pumping station sites, and whereas Delmarva Power has requested the city enter into a utility easement agreement attached tier two that allows Delmarva Power the right to construct, operate, and maintain the infrastructure in association with the new electric services at the pumping stations. Now, therefore, be it ordained by the City Council of the City of Salisbury, Maryland, that City of Salisbury allows Delmarva Power and Light Company to construct, operate, and maintain infrastructure within the Delaware Avenue and Ridge Road pumping station properties, and that the mayor is authorized to execute the utility easement agreements. And although it doesn't actually say it, it should say after agreements attached here too.
Okay, do we need to make that change or is that editorial?
I think that's, I mean, it is attached here too, but I think well, that's editorial.
Okay. All right,
editorial.
Any questions or discussion? All right, seeing none, I'll call the question. All those in favor of adopting ordinance number 2330 for the utility easement for Delmarva Power and Light Company, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. And I'll entertain a motion for ordinance number 2331 for acceptance.
So moved.
Coordinating down here.
Shane, you go.
Shane doesn't
I'm
like
not
these.
Second it.
I'll second it. I was just giving you a chance.
No,
this is for amending Title
I'm
VI
with this.
Of the animals for the Salisbury City Code for beekeeping.
It's a good thing it's not snakes,
Mr. Tillman.
Too.
We have a motion and a second. Mr. Tillman, please.
All right, thank you. An ordinance of the City of Salisbury amending Title VI Animals of the Salisbury City Code to add definitions related to beekeeping and enacting Chapter 6.06 to authorize beekeeping subject to certain regulations. And this ordinance pretty much reads exactly as previously, except I think under the definition of apiary, we eliminated the actual descriptions so that the apiaries will be whatever is permitted by state law at this point.
Yes.
Other than that, it reads exactly as before. And I don't want to bore everybody with that unless you insist.
No. I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
I was reading the ordinance, and it talked about the pollination, and which has declined 50%, and whereas domestic strains of honeybees have been selected breed, and pollination aspirates. Well, if they're in a box, if they're in one of these beekeeping equipments, which is like
hives
and boxes, how do they pollinate anything? Will they mean you're going to let them
fly
loose?
In and out.
When they go out.
Well, that's what they do.
When they go out. So in other words, they're not going to be contained.
No.
No, they go out and gather.
That's the home with an open
that's
door.
That's the problem I have. They're not going to be contained. They're going to be swarming around. That's what I thought.
They build their own little hives everywhere.
They don't
anyway.
Actually swarm, no.
Well, wherever they go, they're going to be loose. They're not going to be in that box.
Well, most of the time, they
what's the purpose of the box?
Making more bees.
And making honey. And making more bees. And a place for the queen to live.
It's no way in the world I can agree with that.
The queen is. I think the queen stays at home.
The queen's the key. You want them to move, you take the queen out and they move. But yeah, they always come back. They'll go out and pollinate the plants and then they'll come back. They bring that pollen back to them.
But they don't sting.
So they'll take making
them. And they're not going to sting anyway while they're pollinating. Can you guarantee? So how are you maintaining this? If someone has. This is the whole concern I've had with this stuff. If you have a beehive and you let these bees loose and they come back, or how are you going to do this stuff? How are you maintaining them? How are you keeping control of the bees? I haven't figured out.
They always come back to where they live.
But they come back, but suppose you're going to tell me they're not going to sting anyone in between the traveling?
Does a dog go out?
They can still sting someone. They still can sting someone. And that's the concern I have. You got these bees close to people's homes, and I guarantee you somebody's not going to do it right. And now you're telling me, when I read this, I said, no, I didn't think these bees are going out. If they're pollinating. That word didn't faze me when I was in work session. They're going to be loose.
Well, I think the deal is here that there are already people with bees. There are more people who want to have bees. And here we are, we're codifying, we're putting law behind what we expect out of people that do have bees and want to have bees.
Well, I don't know who has them, and if they're illegal, they should be fined.
They're not illegal.
Because we don't have a law against it.
We don't have a law against it. Well, I'm just saying that I don't want a beehive next to me. I'd be raising a little holy cane. And I know we can't even sit out here on that bench outside for bees. I couldn't sit on my back step for bees. Now I'm gonna have a neighbor. Say I have been a neighbor have bees and they're gonna be coming back and forth from the beehive. I just have a problem with that. I have people can be allergic to bees that you don't even know they're allergic to bees until they're stung. That's the problem I have. I can understand the pollination. I can understand the farmers and all. Let the farmers have beehives out there in the country. But as far as having beehives within the city in a small area like this and congested, I don't agree with it.
Well, one other thing that's accomplished with this, Ms. Shields, is that it specifies what types of bees can be kept here. Right now, they can keep whatever kinds they want, some that are much more aggressive than the ones that we're permitting here.
It's three against one. I'm not supporting.
Don't count on that, because okay. I'm not.
But I would bet that I would put money on the bugs that are bothering you are not honeybees.
You can't convince me on bees. You can't convince me on none of that stuff in no congested area. Go ahead, let's keep on going.
Yeah, I have a problem with the wasps and some other things,
ahead,
but the honeybees aren't really.
Can we call for the question?
Yeah, call for the question. That's what I'm saying. Go ahead.
Okay. Any further discussion? Okay. Seeing none, I'll call the question on ordinance number 2331 for the honeybees. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Chair votes aye. Cautiously.
And say who's against.
Any opposed?
Yes. Nay.
A very adamant nay from Ms. Shields. So you have two enthusiastic yays, cautious yay, and an enthusiastic nay. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Tillman. We don't have anyone signed up for public comments?
No.
Any comments from anyone else?
I want to say that I hope it rains, so those of you who have a ridiculous reaction to the allergies this year are relieved.
Yeah. I want it to rain and wash the pollen off my car.
That would be nice.
I would just like to make a comment that I had the privilege today of attending the police award at the police headquarters, and Ms. Shields was there as well. And I will tell you, I've never been as proud to be a citizen of Salisbury as I was then, to see what some of these young men and women have done is remarkable, absolutely remarkable. And it's a shame that all we hear is negatives, because that was one of the most uplifting ceremonies I've been to in a long time.
I've been to many of them. Unfortunately, I had to miss that one for another meeting, but Ms. Shields.
Well, I want to say that when I looked at these men, I thought they were children.
Yeah,
They were somebody's family that were coming. They were so young looking. And then when you hear what they've done, and one gentleman I thought was a kid, teenager, he had been on the force 5 years.
5 years.
And it was impressive. Then I saw the lady that's the intel. What does she do? The investigative with the, and I didn't know she'd been on there 15 years, correct?
Crime Am,
okay. And that was amazing, too.
Yeah.
And so a lot of young men, Ivan's son, met Ivan Barkley's son. He like a little kid, you know. But I guess they've got a lot of gumption, you know, a lot of, they're not afraid, bottom line. They're not afraid for what they, the things they have done.
It's remarkable.
They're not afraid to tackle it. And just like when one of the gentlemen saw a house fire, he wasn't afraid to go in and save the elderly lady that he found in his neighborhood in the fire. So those kind of things that made it worthwhile to hear the good things that they've done. And you're not unaware of it because they don't publicize that. They publicize the negative because negatives sell. So I think we have a good police force, and I'm proud of them.
Hear, hear.
You know, you're always going to have one bad apple, but I don't worry about that bad apple because that can be handled. But I think overall our police department is one of the best in the country.
Thank you. I agree.
And then I also want to say where we attended this morning, the Lower Shore Veterans.
Yeah.
That is very, very important to the organizations that have come together to help our veterans with their issues. It was amazing. Community Foundation, the Meeting Community Foundation, what they did, they made a presentation. They've been meeting about a year. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a very important network to be part of because of the homelessness and the mental issues they have, the family issues they have. And I know every time I look at the Wounded Warrior advertisement, it makes tears come to my eyes to see what our boys have gone through and what they, you know, when they go to war and they come, how they come back. So I think that that organization is very, very important, or the organizations that's part of the coalition is very, very important to our community.
Yes. And you can get on the email list with the Community Foundation. I'm sure they shared that today.
Yeah, they shared it. They shared it.
They shared it with us, and I'll be attending those meetings.
I think there were over 50 groups that service that population. Mm-hmm. It was. I didn't realize there were that many groups that help serve.
Yeah, and you'll get emails that there's an issue of a veteran's wife passing and they need help with the burial costs or the placement, or the, and others will chime in back and forth with, try this resource and you're entitled to that, and it really is a great network.
Yep.
And I have to say that most of these organizations work very quietly.
Yeah.
So if you happen to come upon them while they're doing their work, please congratulate them and thank them.
Yes. Again, we hear too much of the negative and not enough of the positive.
Absolutely.
And thank you all for bringing out some of those items from just from today.
Just from today.
Yeah, just from today. Yes.
Absolutely. And speaking of veterans, Tom, isn't this weekend the 15th celebration at Poplar Hill Mansion?
Yes.
And that time, that's at what time?
Saturday at?
Everybody grab your phone.
Saturday's the 16th.
Is it 1 o'clock?
2 o'clock, I think.
Or is the, it is the 16th, yes.
I got it. Hold on.
Okay.
Give me a second.
And this will be, veterans are invited, and it's just a celebration of veterans of all wars.
Yeah.
And their families and their survivors.
1 p.m.
Come down, Poplar Hill Mansion, 1 p.m. Saturday. See you then.
Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. We are adjourned. Thank you.